move now. There we go. Okay. Okay. Evening. So tonight we're going to continue in the vein of wisdom, and we're going to apply it. We spent 2 weeks on finances, money, giving, that kind of thing. I tell you what, if you were not here, I really encourage you to listen to those teachings. The questions and the thoughts that came from those were really, really important for people. So please check those out. Tonight we're going to switch the theme to more family-oriented things, whether it's parenting, marriage, even for singles. You know, ask questions about dating, ask questions about what you would be doing to get ready to be married. Anything that applies to even the relationships, but specifically inside the family, I think that would be good to do tonight. So, let's pray. Thank you, Lord. Your wisdom, Lord. Talk so much here about walking in love, about walking in our original identity of who we really are. But in all those cases, Lord, it's so new for us, Lord, that sometimes we walk in naivete, we walk in a level of innocence that needs something paired with it. And tonight, Lord, I ask that your wisdom would come and be a partner in those things that we're learning to walk in. That our love would be with discernment. That our innocence would be paired with wisdom. Thank you for a people who really are learning to become innocent as doves. But Lord, I ask that we not forsake being wise as serpents. Thank you for this group. Thank you for these people. And Lord, I just ask that you would be the teacher tonight, that wisdom wouldn't be information, that wisdom would be a person, that you would dwell richly among us tonight. And Father, I ask that our hearts would open so that we would not be ashamed of any question we would ask. I thank you that the deep things that we've wondered, the things that have badgered us, the things that seem to keep tripping us up, Lord God, that we would be willing to open up tonight and talk about them so that for once and for all we could step over or step through them. And I ask now, Lord God, that you would give us a beginner's mind. There's a lot of real great knowledge in here, Lord God, but I think some of the beliefs and knowledge that we have keep us from the reality of who you are. And so I ask, Lord God, even with all the good stuff that's in us, can we take every thought captive tonight? That every stronghold that keeps us from really apprehending truth, they would be torn down. May nothing be a sacred cow in our hearts. I honor you, Lord. I honor you, Lord. I honor you. Just read you something here. A good name is to be more desired than great wealth. And favor is better than silver and gold. I feel like Proverbs does a really good job of telling us all the things that are better than money. But still, we have this thing in us that continues to pursue it. The rich and the poor have a common bond. The Lord is the maker of them all. The prudent sees the evil and hides himself, but the naive go on and are punished for it. The reward of humility and the fear of the Lord are riches, honor, and life. Thorns and snares are in the way of the perverse, but he who guards himself will be far from them. Train up a child in the way he should go, and even when he is old, he will not depart from it. I thought it was appropriate to start there. This verse and these verses that lead up to it talk about the naive, how they don't see evil before it comes, and they're punished because they don't see it. And then two verses later, it talks about how a child is to be trained up in the way that he should go. And many times when I've read that verse before, I would think that the parent looks at the child and knows what's best for them, but that's not really what that verse means. That verse actually means that for each child, there's a different way to train them. So you look at each child individually, you know them, you know who they are, you understand them, and then you raise them accordingly. I know a lot of people don't like that word raise when it comes to kids, because I've heard someone say one time, you raise cattle. You don't raise children, but it's a pretty clear word here. Train up a child. It means to disciple. It means to lead in the ways of righteousness a child in the way he should go. So at least as far as parenting goes, it is super, super important for us to recognize that each one of our children are different. They're uniquely made. Just because they have the same last name and grew up in the same house, if you apply the same standards to all four children in every situation, I promise you, one of your children will be very frustrated or more. So discipline, discipling, and training need to be based on who the child actually is. And so that's, before you ever decide to discipline or train a child, you must get to know them. And you've heard the story before of the African tribe that I told you about, who actually, before the baby's ever born, they encourage the mother while the mother is pregnant with the child to pay attention to her dreams. And they actually pray that the mom would have dreams concerning the child. And when she wakes up, she's supposed to tell the entire village what she dreamed about, so the entire village ahead of time can know who this child is before it's ever even in the earth. Or, sorry, here in front of us. And the whole point of that is later on in life, when this child is living and walking around the village all knows who this child is and reminds him or her daily of who they are. And then, for those of you who didn't hear the story, later on in life, if this child does something wrong, instead of strong discipline and criminal action against this person, they instead take them out of the village as a village, surround the child, and then shout his or her identity to it, reminding them of who they are, how good they are, the dreams that mom had about them. And every single time it causes the child to break down and remember who they are. That's why one of the number one things about discipline is it must be based on identity. It can't be based on what you think is good for the child. It really needs to be based on what the father believes about this child and what you know about the child. Discipline is restoration to identity. Whether with this child here, whether with your children, or the father's discipline of you. The whole point of discipline is to restore identity. I saw someone put a quote up, a friend of mine from California put a quote up that Bill Johnson said, that discipline is important because God wants to give you what you want. And so discipline is a way in which you get what you want. And I was like, as much as I honor and respect Bill Johnson, it's got to go better than that. It's got to go deeper than that. And I think this verse here, it's Proverbs 22:6, I believe it tells us that the whole point of training and discipline is to bring, restore, and fix a child on who God originally created them to be. And so when any of our children act outside of their identity, discipline restores that identity. But many times in our anger and our frustration or in our own view of our child, discipline just simply reminds them what they've done wrong or punishes for what they've done wrong. And if we do that consistently over a period of time, guess what a child forgets? Who they are. And what do they remember? What they did wrong. And doesn't that sound familiar? Before long, our identity is no longer child of God. Our identity is sinner. Our idea is rule breaker. Our identity is we can't make it right. We're a screw up. We're an idiot. All of these things. And that's because discipline was never meant to correct behavior. Discipline was meant to remind identity. Okay? In fact, in the midst of the discipline is the word disciple, which means to train, which means to raise up, which means to keep on a certain path. And then if you go, I'm going to tell you right now, I'm not prepared scripturally for this, so I'm just going to let things pop up in my head as they come. Give me just a moment. So I'm just going to... I want you to see this verse here. I did this one time before. I remember where I was when we taught on this. 1 Corinthians chapter 4. I want you to see this again. Verse 14. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, starting in verse 14. This is Paul talking to the Corinthian church, and he talks to them not like a preacher, not like a minister, but like a father. I am not writing this to shame you. That's really important. That word shame means to spin you around reminding you of what you're doing wrong. I'm not writing these things to confuse you, to mess you up, and to constantly remind you of what you're doing wrong, but to warn you. That word warn means to restore you back. You can go look it up later. Trust me. Warn means to set you into the right order, to restore you back onto the proper path. As my what? Dear children, Paul knows Proverbs 22:6. Wouldn't surprise me, he has most of all the Proverbs memorized. So he knows that to train up a child in the way they should go, even though you would have 10,000 guardians or tutors in Christ, let me get to the NAS. This does this to me all the time. Are you guys all there? 1 Corinthians 14, 4, 14, 15. For if you were to have countless tutors in Christ, yet you would not have many fathers. For in Christ Jesus I became your father through the gospel. This is what he's saying. He's saying the law would constantly remind you of what you do wrong. In fact, he says a little bit later, in Romans, so it's beforehand, in Romans 7, he tells his readers in Romans that, hey, you wouldn't have even known sin had the law not come along. And so now that the law comes along, all of a sudden now you realize what you're doing wrong, specifically. The law reminds us of what we're doing wrong. And he goes, thank God the law has come to bring us to grace, bring us to Christ. And there's a shift that takes place from an identity of what we're doing wrong to an identity of what we are to be, what we are originally intended to be. Okay? And so he says here that you no longer just have tutors. You have thousands of tutors. In fact, the word tutor is actually used to describe the law. The law was a tutor that brought us to grace. It's in Romans. Trust me, it's there. And he says here, you have countless tutors in Christ, but you not have many fathers. Tutors remind us of what we're doing wrong and beat us until we do what's right. But what's right to the tutor? That's one of the things. These teachers, these tutors, these guardians of this scripture, he's contrasting tutors and guardians and teachers with a father. And there's a huge difference between the two. Tutors try to make robots of themselves. Tutors try to convince you, this is what I know and you need to know what I know. And once you know what I know, I'm successful and you'll be okay in life. A father doesn't think that way at all. A father does not think in terms of knowledge. A father thinks in terms of maturity. A father thinks in terms of everything that's on inside of the child coming forth. A father knows that there's no way the son can be just like the father. A son must become who he is. And a father's role is to create an atmosphere by which the son can fully discover all that he is. Very different than a tutor who tests you on the knowledge he gave to you. So far, so good? Yeah. And so fathering, parenting in general, your homes, our homes, our crucibles, our petri dishes, our laboratories by which each one of our individual children, and even our husband and wife, fully discover who they are. That's what a home really is. A home is not a place that we pay a mortgage in. A home is not a place where dinner is cooked. A home is not a place to store our clothing and our furniture. A home is a place where people discover who they are and have and get to practice walking in it. That's a huge part of it. Home has got to be a place where we practice everything we do outside of it. You should write that one down. That's good. Home is a place where you practice everything you will do outside of it. Here's the problem. Most people do one thing in their home and another thing outside of it. I've said this many times. If what I believe, preach, and teach here doesn't first work in my home, I should never say it here. Ever. My wife and my four children are my first church. And if it doesn't work with them, I have to seriously look at what's going on. So the home for me is a place where I practice. I walk out what I believe is right in my home, and then I walk it out here. So, yeah. I think for some reason we have this mindset that we can act any way we want to at home, and then we have to put on our good girl and good boy faces when we leave. And I just think that's family religion. I think that's what it is. I think it's, oh, I walk outside and I can treat my wife or my husband or my kids one way, but when we're here, then I'll treat them well. Well, where do you spend the majority of your time with that person? What are they going to believe about us? What are they going to believe about themselves? Do you guys get me? Yep. Wisdom recognizes that the home is not a place for you to hide out and be whatever you want. Home is a place where you practice who you really are. That's why we don't have tutors that raise children. We have moms and dads. Because moms and dads are supposed to see their children different than their teachers do. But what's really sad in a lot of our societies today, because children are growing up in fatherless homes or homes where they're abused or ignored or at least tolerated, then we hope that our children will find a teacher or mentor or someone outside the home that can remind them of who they really are. And it's a really sad state of our society. That's why I believe the church must be founded on what our homes are like. So I'll be really honest with you. What happens here is what happens in the Durniak house. You can ask any of my kids. You know, if I screw up here, I promise you I screw up there. I am as real here in front of you as I am with them. That's why I didn't mind saying the word penis a bunch of times behind the microphone. Because if we can't talk real here, if we can't talk about the things that I talk about at home, then why are we talking about it at home? I don't think there is a, well, there's certain things just to talk about here. And I don't. I believe this is spiritual family as much as anything. So, I don't know. Maybe that's why the church is still small. Just need more kids. Well, there you go. Any questions so far?
Is there a place for punishment?
What does punishment mean to you, Aaron?
I'm asking the questions.
I really need to know what punishment looks like to you so I can understand it.
So punishment is some sort of consequence. Mm-hmm. Punishment is... no cell phone privilege. Punishment is, that's an example. And I know we've talked before about not sending somebody away. And but consequences, I guess. I guess I look at punishment as consequences.
Consequences you create versus consequences that are created because of their behavior.
Consequences that are imposed upon.
Okay, so that you create.
Yes.
Yeah. I think that, this is this personal opinion, Mrs. Durniak might even have a little different opinion, but, and she can have the microphone if she'd like it. I think our own imposed consequences hide the actual consequences of their behavior, often. So what we do is our punishment, often as a result of how we feel about their behavior, is imposed. And the result is, instead of the focus on what I was actually doing and the effect it had on myself or other people, I'm more focused on the fact that I don't have my cell phone for 2 weeks. And then it kind of becomes a reverse bribery, where instead of focusing on the fact that my behavior actually hurt this other person, I'm focusing on just being good so I can have my cell phone back. So there's my reasoning why I think punishment can definitely be taken to an extreme and can have a reverse effect, where basically, you know, we're giving a child M&Ms if they pee in the potty. And I'm not saying that's bad, because I remember doing that. But it's a bribery thing to get them to pee where you want them to pee. And before long, if you want your cell phone, don't talk back. Instead of, hey, do you know what talking back does? You know what it will do to you later in life if you talk back to a college professor or a boss or your husband or your wife? You know, so I'm not against consequences, but I think they need to definitely not be the focus. I think the behavior and the resulting effect it had on them and on the other person has to be the focus. Does that help?
Is that age specific? Does it depend on the maturity level of the child?
Definitely. Yeah, I think the younger they are, the more that there's probably need for just unexplained discipline. And in most, I'll just be honest with you, I believe in capital. Is it capital? Yeah. Corporal? No, I do not believe in capital. Hold on a second.
Sure. Just got real.
Yeah, there were more children that we had. Sorry. Strike that from the internet recording. I do believe in corporal punishment. I believe it's right. I believe it's appropriate. I believe if you spare the rod, you spoil the child. I really do. And I believe there's somewhere else in Proverbs. Actually, I think I have one of those verses here. Yeah. Foolishness is bound up in the heart of the child, but the rod of discipline will remove it far from him. The younger they are, obviously, the less they can understand reasoning. Okay. Hi, Jim. You have something to say about disciplining children?
No.
Okay. Okay, well, we're not there yet, so. excuse me? I'm answering a question that someone asked. Okay? I haven't even answered it yet. You should be listening.
I'm going to take away the microphone.
Yeah. Can I answer my... Can I...
Today, the kids use that to get away with them.
Sure, I agree.
If you try and touch him or whatever,
you don't call the cops. Well, I think that's because we're using the wrong type of discipline on that child. If you're having to use corporal punishment on an older child that can call the cops, you didn't do your job when they were younger. I'm just being honest with you. And if you want to challenge me on that, we can sit down. But I believe that there is a way where you can raise your child up when they're young with proper corporal punishment that is not abusive but brings life to the child. And when you do that, you are not using reasoning on a 3-year-old and then trying to beat a 13-year-old. Because you are, by the time you're beating a 13-year-old, you haven't done your job younger and you're just frustrated. I think a 13-year-old needs sat down and reminded of the discipline you gave them when they were younger and why it was given to them. I think the older they get, the more your discipline should echo something from their past, not be a new information. Okay? So, yeah, a little swat to the butt, a little to the mouth when they backtalk you, things like that. Those are very stark reminders to that age. And you do not have to beat them for them to know that they've done something wrong. In fact, in most cases, one quick little swat on the bottom is a wake-up, is a reset to the current behavior that they're operating in. It does not need to be a lot. In fact, I think the more you beat them, the more they need it in order to listen to you. And then eventually they tune you out altogether. Consistency is the key. Discipline in its definition is consistent. Discipline in its definition is pattern, ongoing, lifestyle, relational. Okay? Discipline does not come in after the fact and try to correct bad behavior. Discipline walks along with someone while they're acting perfectly good and reminds them that they're doing really well. Unfortunately, in today's society, discipline is something that comes in after the fact and punishes. That's not discipline. That's punishment. Discipline walks right alongside the child while they're doing well, reminds them they're doing well, and then when they step off the path, it reminds them that they're stepping off the path. And because you've walked with them while they were doing well, they will immediately listen to you when you say you've stepped off the path. The problem is we don't walk in relationship. We step in after the fact, swat them, and they go, what's that about? Because we weren't walking with them when things were good. Okay, Randy.
I don't have anything. You answered everything that I was...
Beautiful.
Just by listening.
Okay.
What you're saying kind of reminds me of when I was in the military. What they talked about is, like, the military's discipline is majorly about punishment. Like, you toe the line or, you know, we throw the book at you. Because, like, they tell you all the time about, you know, set examples out of people and just, you know, it happens all the time. And it was really encouraging. There was a 3- or 4-star general in the Air Force that would come into our shop every once in a while. And he would talk about, you know, the discipline in the military is all based on punishment. He would just come in every once in a while and he would hand out some of his coins to some of the people that worked there that had done really well. He's like, you know, they focus too little on promoting and, like, you know, encouragement of good activity and just punish. Mm-hmm. And it drowns out everything else.
Right. Jim, do you want to say something? You sure? Okay. Yep.
I feel like this extends beyond just parent and child relations. It's almost any kind of relationship that there is a leader and followers. Like, whether it's, you know, work or group projects or anything like that. That as soon as you start throwing the book at them, you get less and less of who they really are. Mm-hmm. And more and more just kind of like resentment.
I mean, you can get people to behave the way you want them to behave. You can. You can force people and punish people and consequence the crap out of people, and you will eventually get the behavior you want, but you won't have their heart. Okay? Just let me finish this thought, because this is really important. If you really want people to walk in who they were created to be, you must go to their heart. And you do not get to their heart by throwing the book at them, by disciplining, by beating them. Trust me, those soldiers, for the most part, are fighting to cover and protect one another. I've talked to enough soldiers to say that it was all about the brotherhood. It was all about covering one another's backs because they were all equally suffering, in whether it was boot camp or whether it was in the actual throes of war. They were really covering one another. They weren't fighting because they loved their president or they loved their general, unless it was a general like you just described. But the reality is that if you want the devotion of someone, if you want them to really believe in your leadership and in what you're doing, we have to go to the heart. And the heart, so for example, in fathering, I'm actually speaking to what you just said. I believe we can father in the workplace. Because it's not about saying, all of these workers are my kids. That's a wrong approach. It's having the father's heart in the workplace. It's being when you're with someone who is a quote-unquote employee or a member of your group project or team, it's treating them the way the father would treat them. To see them the way the father sees them. So it's not seeing them as a child. It is seeing them valuable. It is seeing this incredible creature trapped within some bad habits, for example. And instead of focusing on the bad habits, which we said before, I promise you, you keep focusing on their bad habits, you will reinforce that it's who they are. Instead of focusing on who they are, it begins to shed the bad habit. I've seen it so many times in my own personal life and the lives of people I'm close to. When I don't focus on what they do wrong, but continually remind them of who they are, eventually who that person becomes does not like who they're not. Has anybody discovered that for themselves? The more someone believes in you, trusts you, and inspires you, the less the behavior that's not you is comfortable. The less comfortable it becomes. And before long, you don't realize, I'm not even acting that way anymore. Because it's one thing to beat them into submission and convince them based on rules and consequences to breaking the rules that they won't behave bad and they will behave good, but you won't have their heart. And at the end of the day, I think I would much rather have 20 people's hearts than 50 people's good behavior. I would. Because at the end of the day, it's what's going to, you know, if you ask me, my goal is a redeemed earth. My goal is a people on the planet who reflect the nature and character of the Father. And deep inside every human being is the nature and character of the Father. His name is Jesus. And when we love people the way they were intended to be loved, that Jesus nature on the inside of every human being comes forth naturally. Okay. Do you have the microphone? You need the microphone.
First of all, I love this topic. Well, right now I'm getting some good results, and I think it's from what you said about the discipline thing, yeah. However, this is the other thing that I'm going to reinforce because you did make a point about it. You brought it out. And it's this. What I'm going to say is expectation of who you know they are. And that's what you're bringing to your children, I believe that. Well, my daughter said she likes to sing. I hurry up and put her on stage. She wants to sing? Okay, she needs to see herself singing, regardless of whether she made a career of it or not. Somebody else, I know my parents treated me like that. They saw the expectation and they encouraged it. Well, sometimes I don't see the expectation and I got expected anyway. So I'm always encouraging the best out of them. Mistakes we all make. Growing up, they got their problems. However, they want to see the other side. I do believe children are like this, and I didn't have many of them, but I got a couple. They want to see the other side of that behavior that they didn't grow into yet. I see it. I mean, because I'm grown already, so I kind of know the process. But I think they're grateful when you encourage them to go towards what they may be a little insecure about or something like that. And like you said about the beliefs, that is a big thing with children, I'm telling you. My parents did it to the degree that they did, thank God. But to me, they didn't do it enough, but they did what they could. But I have the opportunity to encourage everybody's children, not only just mine, because I understand the beauty and the importance of that, seeing that vision for them until they can see it for themselves. Well, you cannot reach that goal if you're having this kind of behavior, okay? They need to know that.
That's really good.
So I keep up that vision. I mean, I don't know what my kids might say, but I don't try to be real demanding of it, but the expectation is there, and I do expect them to be the best. But you know, not everybody's coming with a lot, so you just gotta understand that they will get what they need to get in the process of them growing towards who they are. That's all I want to say. So thank you for bringing up that point.
Thank you. I remember my mom being like overtly proud of me on every little thing I did. Anybody else's mom that way? Almost like sickeningly so. And she'd always remind me of how great I am and how, oh, you're such a good this and you're such a good that. And I actually started rolling my eyes sometimes. But on the other side of that coin was my dad, who would constantly tell my mom, hey, don't be telling him all that stuff. It's going to ruin him. It's going to spoil him. It's going to convince him that he's already arrived and things like that. And at first I was like, no, Dad, I'm enjoying this over here. Let's just keep this going, because every time I would do something good, I'd hear how great I was. And then my mom didn't realize all that she was doing, but she was really walking in some of these things. I think she had a real apprehension of the Father's heart. And so did my dad. And I recognized pretty quickly as I got older that my mom and my dad were two really important tensions in my life. They were two extremes where my dad was overly corrective. And most of the time, I found out later, he was overly corrective because mom was overly encouraging. She was. You know, I mean, she brought discipline, but it wasn't very often. It was usually she told me how great I was and how important I was going to be and all this kind of stuff. Doggone, I started believing it. I really did. And then my dad would always remind me of all the things I was doing that kept me from that, just like you said. And so I don't know if moms and dads ever, in this room anyway, have ever conflicted about what to do with your child. But I just want you to know that that is not only possible, I believe it's important. Do you need to eventually agree? Yes. But you should not see the same way. You should not. There is a reason why there is a mother and a father. You should have contrasting points of view as it relates to this, because that tension creates a perfect balance for that child, if expressed properly, okay? If one is overly expressing and the other one, because of the overly expressing, is backing off, someone better step up. Because the whole point is, as one overly expresses, this one should also express so that it brings balance to the one's expression. Okay? I've watched this so many times, not only in parenting, but even in relationships, where one becomes overtly emotional about something and the other backs off. And I feel like that is so opposite of how God created our relationships to be. Our relationships were meant to balance one another. We weren't meant to balance ourselves. So, you know, any mom and dad in here, like this is the first mom and dad I can see that are both in here. So if Chris is doing his thing and is acting fully as a father or even as a husband, the only way that that's properly balanced is if Amanda is fully being mother and wife. But if she's having an off week or an off day and she just backs off all of that and Chris is fully being himself, it's out of balance in the home. And there will probably be too much in whatever it is that's your nature and character to bring to the marriage and to the family. It will be a lot of Chris, but there's not the Amanda to balance it. Like, this is really important that you guys hear this. There must be all in from both. Okay? And again, this is one of the travesties of fatherless or motherless homes. Because a father can't be a mother, and a mother, no matter how hard you try, you cannot be a father. Kids that grow up in fatherless homes, they know beyond a shadow of a doubt that mom loves them. And they will do everything in their power to make sure mom is always taken care of. Go look at any football player. One of the first things they do when they sign a contract and get a signing bonus, what do? They buy mom a house. They buy mom a car. They buy mom something. Take pair of bills, something. Okay? It's almost always mom. Because they know mom loves them. And it breaks my heart because many of these barely, and if it wouldn't have been for someone else stepping in, a coach, a teacher, something, these kids would have never made it to where they are to have that contract in the first place. So I really want to encourage you, mom and dad, it's created by God on purpose. The full manifestation of mother and father, I believe, sets in. And also for marriage. I like to dance around all different subjects, keep you on your toes. But in a marriage setting, if one's laying back and the other one's strong, I can promise you there's unfulfillment on both sides. Both sides. There's a tension in Scripture. One time the Lord is telling us to give it all away. The next time he's telling us to save and to be wise with our money. One time he's telling us to love and bless and turn the other cheek, and the next moment he is confronting a Pharisee. You can go throughout the Bible and you can find one scripture that says one thing and one scripture that says the exact opposite. And people have used that to invalidate scripture. I say that's the wholeness of God. Man, I can tell you at different times I am bringing the thunder down in my home. And if you think that's wrong, I can show you a lot more in Scripture where the Lord brought the thunder. And then there's other times where I am the weeping, crying, hugging father or husband. And I think that's the full nature and manifestation of the Father. This idea that that you shouldn't discipline in anger, where'd that come from? Seriously, whose idea was that? I know it sounds good because you don't want to like break your child's arm or neck. But that's actually a self-control issue. That's not an anger issue. I need you to know this. There's a difference between anger and self-control. You're supposed to be angry at times. It is biblically appropriate to be angry. But somewhere along the line, we've been convinced of ourselves that love never gets angry. No, love is not easily angered. Do you guys hear this? Okay? It's not, you can't provoke me to anger. But I can tell you this, if I see you step outside of your identity and you continue to do it patterned and consistently, something will rise up on the inside of me and it's love. And I will be righteously angry with that. And I will speak to you and I will relate to you in that anger. And that's legitimate. The Lord does it all the time. The problem is I should not sin in my anger. Why else would Paul say, be angry but sin not? Where are you going? All right, I got to find it. Someone want to find that for me? It's in there. Okay, so there's got to be a reason why he tells you to do both. Be angry but don't sin in your anger. As soon as you sin in your anger, now you give what? Remember what it says next? You give the devil a foothold. Okay? Being angry does not give the devil a foothold. That is a huge fallacy. And before long, what we do is we neuter the church. Ephesians 4:26. Did you hear what I just said? It's really important. If we take anger out of the Christian walk, we have neutered us. And we've become a nice church. Jesus was not this nice, jolly, Santa Claus type savior. No, he was very determined. He looks at Peter and says, get behind me, Satan. I want to tell you, that's not a, hey, get behind me, Satan. No, that is a, you do not know what you're saying. Get behind me, get out of my way so I can fulfill my purpose. That is determination. That is anger at someone standing in the way of identity and destiny. There has to be that rises up on the inside of us. Just don't sin in that. Well, what does that mean, Mark? It means don't tear someone else down in your anger. What? Okay, keep your heart open. You can keep your heart open and be angry. In fact, I think it's one of the ways, it's the only way you can be angry is when your heart opens. Because when your heart starts to close, you're just like, I don't care. I can promise you, if someone makes you angry, your heart's more open to them than you realize. Your heart deceives you. If you can get angry with me, your heart's open to me. Because I've gotten in there. Hello? Yeah. So I want to redeem anger. Anger's good. I believe anger steers us in a good posture away from things that are unrighteous. Holly?
So why does it say put away anger and malice?
Well, malice is bad. Yeah, well, again, there's your tension in Scripture again. And that's the same guy that says, love is not easily angered, and then Paul says, put away anger and malice. Okay? It's both. There are times where we then become habitually angry. Has anybody been just angry for angry's sake? You ever been on a roll of anger? Like, I'm good, I got them all, I'll knock you all down with my anger. Okay, that's not good. But there are times where anger is based and rooted in love and comes up and says, you shouldn't be that way. There's a better way for you. I believe that is the most righteous, loving thing you could do for someone in that moment. Okay, we need a microphone back there. No.
Yes, right. Hearing that, it made me think that in my master's program, they talk about anger being a secondary emotion. And so, and this is just like kind of spitballing, that maybe anger itself is not the problem, but what it is that's feeding you towards anger. So the root of whatever it is. So
the motive.
Yeah, the motive. So, yep. So like the specific issue that's causing you to be angry. So if love's your motivation, then that's not going to be an issue. But if it's other things that are motivating you towards
good
anger,
job.
Then that's...
Thank you. What's that?
That's where Psalms 4:4 comes in. Psalms 4:4 says, don't sin by letting anger control you. Think about it overnight and remain silent.
Yep. Here's Proverbs 22:24. Do not associate with a man given to anger. Did you guys hear that? It means anger does not have to rule you. It doesn't have to be something that's your immediate... I know people that as soon as you even say the wrong word, like they're just waiting to get angry. Okay, that's not the kind of anger we're talking about, okay? We're talking about an anger that waits a long time. All right, I'll put up with it this time. I'm going to let it go again. I'm going to let it go one more time. Okay. But in the process of letting something go, you're also, you're doing something else other than getting angry. Okay? If you don't do anything else but get angry, I promise you, you're going to start becoming angry regularly. But if Devin acts outside of his identity and I don't step in and remind him, and then he does it again, and I don't step in and remind him, I promise, anger and resentment will rise up in me, and then I will lash out at him. Instead, each time you do that, I remind you, hey, man, I know who you are. Hey, did you see what you did there? That really hurt so-and-so, but it really reflected bad on who I know you are. And over time, I might not even have to walk in that anger because he will then, oh, yeah, you're right. Do not associate with a man given to anger or go with a hot-tempered man. Or you will learn his ways and find a snare for yourself. So there is a balance between walking in anger and that occasional rising up of anger in love, because the root of anger should be love. In fact, I'd like to say the root of all of our responses to people should be love. Yeah. All right. Questions? All right. Microphone.
So, my wife and I, with the whole discipline thing, sometimes whenever I discipline the kids, she looks at me and says, we're not on the same page with discipline, because I'm more strong on discipline the kids sometimes, and she's a little more laid back, or I'm a little more laid back, and she's a little more quick to discipline. And is that okay?
What's the reason why you're a little more laid back one time and quick to discipline another?
Well, because sometimes she's right there in the midst of it, and they're within arm's reach, I've heard to get a hold of them. Hey, I'm just giving you an example. You know, and
so why one time is Randy slow to discipline and another time quick to discipline? I'm asking you a question. Well, or maybe Becky can answer it. One time.
It's pure laziness. There you go. I get tired of like doing it and doing it, although I know that I should be consistent in disciplining every single time, all the time, but I just get wear it out sometimes.
Sure.
So it's just laziness.
Yeah. That's why discipline has got to be consistent. It is the number one, in my mind, if you want to call it a rule, I hate the word, but I'll use it. The number one rule of discipline, it has to be consistent. If you do the same thing every time, especially when they're young, you'll have a lot less times where you have to do it and a lot shorter period of time where you have to do it.
Yeah. I have a question.
Well, can I finish that thought? Yeah. Because there's more thought to that. So the other reason why I think you're slow one time and quick another is because it's based in emotion. If the root of our discipline is emotion, I can promise you that's the reason why you're inconsistent. Because one time you're having a pretty good day and you're not tired of it and you can put up with it, so you'll just let it go. And another time you're on it like a tiger on a new piece of beef. It all depends on your day, your mood, where you're at, what's going on outside of your life, all of that. Hey, man, I know it. Trust me, I know it. So, again, the root of everything should be love. So the root of our discipline needs to be love. And don't forget, discipline is not just coming in after bad behavior. Please hear that. You weren't here for when I said that, so I want to say that to you too. Discipline is walking alongside of your child the whole way. It's having relationship with them when they're doing well and you remind them of how well they're doing, so that when you bring the other side of that, when they're not doing well and you remind them of that, they're very quick to respond to you. I think the reason why our children are slow to respond to our discipline is because they have not heard enough encouragement when they're doing things well. And I tell you what, I'm just as guilty as anyone else of this. When my kids are doing good, just may they continue to keep doing good. And we forget to tell them. We forget to remind them, that was great. That celebration, that recognition of what they do well is all of the foundation you need that when you bring correction, it's immediately responded to. And I think when you said laziness, I think that's a key. So go ahead. Finish your thought or question.
I'll ask later. Well, I just really wanted to know, like, how this is probably, I would think, for, like, you or Diane, because I watch you guys with your kids. How do you get a kid to stop screaming at the top of their lungs without, like, grabbing a hold of them? Because, like, I can't. Like, you can't, like,
glad that wasn't on the mic
or anything, but like they don't just stop screaming. Like, I'm talking,
he's two
screaming. Help me out here.
Do we know why at some point in time later? Do we think about it later and realize why?
It's because he's not getting his own way about something. Are you still paying attention to him? No, I'm ignoring it. But, like, when you're in the middle of Walmart, like, I just cover his mouth. Because I don't know what else to do.
You take him out of the toy section. He's in the cart. So what is he doing?
How do you feel? He really doesn't scream like that at him.
Hey, Dawn, do you want to help out here?
Well, I just remember having four very different children, and surprisingly, Anderson was the one that would scream in the middle of the store. He didn't care. He didn't care. And then I had three older girls who were like, Mom, what are you going to do about that? We were so embarrassed. We're like, oh, my gosh. But I don't remember, like, we just, oftentimes we would try to remove him from the situation or just... We would never give in to him just to get him to stop. that's one thing I can tell you not to do better than I can tell you what to do, because you have to be really creative about how to handle it. I know that's not very helpful.
Can I build on that?
Well, I definitely don't give it to him.
But, yeah, I mean, I remember being very humiliated at times and being like, I would probably cover his mouth and things like that, but at some point, sometimes you just can't. Go ahead. You want to say something?
No. I crushed my thing. I'm sorry. Go ahead, finish.
I'm good.
Don't ignore it. I think that's the worst thing you can do. I think they need to know that they're doing it, and I think that they need to know that you know they're doing it, and you will not stand for it. I think the mistake most parents make when a child's throwing a temper tantrum, because that's what you just described, is that we try to ignore it, thinking that it'll just wear itself out. Kids have an amazing endurance.
Oh, I don't ignore it at home, in our own home, but when we're out in public, it's like...
Yeah. You know what I would do? I remember doing...
Yeah, the other thing you can do is just take them to the car. Yep, like exactly one of us, if we'd be together, one of us would have to take them outside. Because you can't deal with it.
And I want to tell you something. After once or twice, and I'm walking to the car with them the third time, they know what's going to happen in that car. And I'm not saying beat the tarla. I'm not saying that. But they know that they're going to get very strong attention. Yeah. It did stop. And I will tell you, it did not take long. The thing that I think we mess up is where we act like it'll just stop on its own, or that somehow they're going to just grow out of it. They don't grow out of it. I've seen teenagers just have a teenage version of a temper tantrum, where they don't talk to mom for weeks, where they just hole up emotionally. That's a temper tantrum for a teenager. So they need to know now that we're very attentive to it. We will not put up with it. Like, there are so many times where I'm walking around a store, and some parent, I want to parent the world sometimes. Because when the child's just in Walmart or in, let's pick a different store. Let's pick a better store. Let's pick Target. Okay. And it's just like just sitting in the car, just screaming. And every 5 or 10 seconds, the parent just looks over and says, shut up. And then just goes back to shopping. Would you just shut up? And then And you notice it doesn't change the child's behavior at all. Nothing changes. Because first of all, they've been tuned out. And second of all, that way of speaking to them is, it's demeaning. It is not cutting through to the real reason why. Do you know the reason why almost every child has a temper tantrum? Attention. They're not getting their own way. So they think if they get more of your attention, they'll eventually get their own way. They need to know from the beginning that the world does not revolve around them. That's the beginning of it. Are they incredible? Yes. Are they the Father's apple of his eye? Yes. But it doesn't mean that everybody else in this world was born to serve them and get whatever they want. And that firm and quick attention to a temper tantrum reminds them that I'm one of many. They don't know that at 2 years old and 3 years old, but at 12 and 13 and 14 years old, they'll know it then. Because somewhere along the line, someone said, I'm not putting up with that. So I remember leaving you in the store many times. I remember you teaching kids' church here and me having to deal with that one. Because she wouldn't sit in church. I don't know if anybody else has a child like that. But Maddie wouldn't just sit there with me in church. Dawn was the kids director here. She was our first one. And I remember not being able to handle Maddie at all. Like, Maddie was trouble. She was trouble. I really thought that she had an aversion to the anointing of the Lord. I really did. I'm not kidding you. I remember Mom and I talking about this. I'm like, I don't think she likes the Lord, because every time we get into worship, she's just like, I can't sit. I cast you out in Jesus' name. I would have to stand in the back while Gene or someone else is preaching. trying to keep, and I'm looking in the window wondering if Dawn's done with kids' church yet. And when you would throw a temper tantrum, there was another set of doors at Shalom. You remember there was two sets of doors, one that took you right out where we met, and another that took it down a hallway and out. Oh, there were multiple times I had you down that hallway and out that door. and I did cast something out of you. I know I did. There was the laying on of hands that took place. But in all seriousness, look.
It worked.
Look. She's incredible. And I'm not taking credit for that because I did that. I'm just telling you, when they if you're consistent and don't take no for an answer, so to speak, when they're young, I promise you, this works. Being faithful as a parent works. You are not a mean ogre. And the shorter period, sorry, the more consistent you are at being the mean ogre, the less amount of time you have to be one. If you are consistent on it, I will not let this continue. It's a very short period of time, and you have who you want. Now, some have a little will that's a lot stronger than others, and it takes a little bit longer. Okay? You're not trying to break their will. You're trying to shape it. You're trying to properly direct it. I don't like the idea of breaking will. You're not trying to break the will of a child. You are shaping it and properly directing it. Okay? Because there is sin in this world. And it's not just in TV and movies. It is being rained down in the atmosphere at our children. And the more effective you are at training and shaping and directing that will, the more they step against the sin that's rolling against them.
Obviously, I'm not a mom, but I am the oldest of four. And I was kind of brought up in a household where my mom wasn't always present. So, like, I kind of took on the responsibility as mom. So is it safe to say, and I've experienced this even in my own, like, relationships as well, that the lack of discipline that you experience from your parent, the rightful one that has the authority to discipline you, if that doesn't happen, you don't experience that growing up, you begin to disrespect and not open up to other people who want to speak into you.
Absolutely.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, because you actually think that
because you think that they're attacking you.
Yeah, our actual fathering is inappropriate.
Right.
Yep.
So then that breeds a counterfeit idea of what tough love looks like when you have people who are willing to see you for who you are and walk with you in a consistent discipline of love.
Yeah. And the result is the kind of discipline and training that he just described in the military. Because I think that's the only response to a lack of fathering or proper parenting.
And I think it's really important, too, by, like, seeing the heart of someone, like, you know, that maybe didn't have that kind of discipline. Whereas if you are able to know, like, if you're able to know their heart, then you're able to know how to respond to them. Because in a way, it's like they have to relearn this all over again.
Yeah.
So it's almost like bringing them back to a childlike state where there is an authority figure, whether you're a sister, a brother, a mother, whatever, someone in the church. It's a new process for them. It's a relearning process. Mm. And sometimes you have to do that, and that's why it's so important to be consistent. Because when you have a relationship with someone who that's a foreign concept, it's hard at first, but then as you be consistent with it, they learn to know that it is a natural way to walk with somebody.
Very good. Thank you. Hey. Yeah, I want to go back to the breaking the will thing because there's something else I want to say there. Has everybody heard it?
I just want to say something real quick.
Sorry.
Before we get too far out there. So, like, back at Walmart, say we're in the toy department, and we've removed the child because he was throwing a temper tantrum. So, and it takes a lot of effort, but at some point, you want to give that child what they were expressing they wanted. But you want to do it in a very different scenario, so he doesn't think,
we're rewarding the temper tantrum.
If I do this, I'll get a toy. If I have a temper tantrum, I'll get the toy. So you want, like, another time, give it another opportunity. And it might not work that time. It might. But just assess the situation and see, can we go back to Walmart, this is what you wanted, and give it another shot in a completely different atmosphere. You know what I mean?
That's really good. I want to go back to the breaking of the will, but she opened up another thought. Dawn and I, for the last, I don't know, couple weeks before Thanksgiving and right after Thanksgiving, we were looking for a new car for Dawn. And one of the great mistakes I made was taking Anderson with me. Because he's an incredible researcher. But he also thinks that every car I look at, I should buy. And every one we get in, Dad, this is it. This is the one. We should buy this. Look at this car. And then when I would drive away from the lot, he'd be upset. Dad, what the heck? Why didn't we get it? Why aren't we buying this car? And it got to the point where we said, we're never buying a car. I can just tell us right now, we're never buying a car. He got mad that one point when we walked away from that one over on, at Hamilton. He was like, he was crying. Don't you dare tell him. If you tell him I said this, I will deny it and I'll call you a liar. He doesn't watch. There's good parenting. Don't take notes right now. He cried as we left that parking lot because we all took it for a ride. The whole family was in the vehicle. It had a the screen that comes down and plays the movie. It had a set of headphones. He was like, this is it. This is my car. And we drove away. I remember in the car, Mom or Dawn and I saying, we're not buying that car. He turned his head away from me. He's trying not to let me know. He is crying so bad. And there was a part of me that was like, I'm going to wig out on him because it happened like four times. And it was kind of like a 12-year-old temper tantrum. It was a version of it. Now, Anderson's temper tantrums are like piece of cake, okay? But still, it was something that needed to be addressed. And so I recognized right away that this was not something that was just going to be addressed with, you know, any kind of basic thing. So Dawn and I had to sit down with him and talk to him about money. Talk to him about the value of money and what it buys and what it, how long it takes to choose the right thing, to do the right research. And sometimes you have to look at many things before you buy one thing. And it took a while. In fact, I think he had to go to sleep on it. But the next morning he woke up and he was like, I remember him saying this. You're right, that's not our car. Because then he started thinking about all the other things about it that I tried to show him that I didn't like about it, that it wasn't right for us. And but at that time, it was just all about wanting the toy. Really expensive toy. But he wanted the toy so bad. But then when he woke up, after he, I think Dawn and I really recognized we can reason with Anderson. He kind of, he crossed the threshold into reason. Where now, you know what, you kind of know when a child's no longer receiving the kind of more basic physical correction because it's not changing their behavior. That's when it's time to start practicing reasoning with them. And I recognized that Anderson was ready for reasoning, and it worked. He woke up the next morning and pointed about four or five things of that vehicle of why that's not the right car. And then the next day, we're at Thanksgiving. I'm in Fuddruckers tiling floor. And I said, hey, let's just drive by the parking lot and let's look at this one car lot. And we found our car. And he saw the peace that came in me. He saw that all the features that we were looking for were in this car. And he had the same peace I had about the vehicle. And it was a really cool way of watching that teaching take place. So back to breaking the will. I can't believe I remembered. The reason, the source of the theology of breaking will, do you know where that comes from? The source theology for having to break a child's will is the idea that a child is born sinful. So you have to break that sinful will and then reteach them a holy will. I think that's a really broken way of looking at children. I think children are born with a really strong will for the Lord's purposes. So what we need to do is direct that will by the Holy Spirit. We have to teach them to submit that will to the Holy Spirit. Submit that will to proper authority, whether it be the parents, whether it be God himself, whether it be a boss. Someday, you've got really strong people working for you at World Kitchen. If they had that strong will submitted to the direction you had, could you imagine what could happen? But oftentimes they take that strong will and they work it against the very authority that it was meant to serve. Somewhere along the line, that child's will was not shaped and directed appropriately. So when authority comes in that's different than their will, the first intention, fight. But as our children grow, I don't have to break my children's spirit. I have to teach them that that spirit was meant to submit to authority. First God's, then parents, bosses, teachers, whatever. And when that takes place, I want to tell you, you want to talk about promotion? Think about that. Think about someone with strength submitting to your authority. Wouldn't that be the first person you would look for to raise up? Absolutely. But we think, fight against the authority, fight against the man. So we don't break will. We shape it. We direct it. We teach it how to submit. I think the greatest thing a man can do, Jesus did it, is submit his will to the Jewish authorities, to Pilate. He's standing before Pilate, and he says, "You ain't got nothing over me except the Father gave it to you. So you better be thankful right now. Because I could, like, in 1 second, I could make you into Nebuchadnezzar, and you could be go out in the woods and think you're a wild animal. In 1 second. But instead, I'm submitting this to you for the purposes of God." That's when you know. That's true strength, is when you submit your strength. How many people in here grew up with the paddle in school? Yeah. Well, I mean specifically in school. I remember every room had a paddle. The ones that really scared me are the ones that drilled holes in them. Oh, man. You have one? Oh, you got it. Oh, okay. You literally got it. See you, buddy. We love you. One thing about, this is the last thing I'm going to say about corporal punishment. We can talk about it later. Not capital, corporal. It can be abuse, and I have seen it be abuse. I have seen people jerk their kids by their arms and drag them out of places. And I'm going to tell you, that's abuse. I love that guy. Did you see him on Sunday? He had it on speaker, and he's talking. I finally said, "Hey, man, can you take it off speaker?" He's like, "Oh, yeah, sorry." I don't want to be the person that kind of gives the very specific rules about corporal punishment because I don't think there is such a thing. I've heard many people teach about not using your physical hand, like using like a paddle or a something else. That way a child doesn't think of your hand as a weapon. That makes a lot of sense. I don't know if I didn't subscribe to that because I couldn't find something at the time or... I never had that problem, let's just put it that way. Because I didn't do it that much that every time they saw my hand, they winced like a dog that had been kicked. I did it when it was needed and I did it swiftly and I did it and I finished. And when it was done, I immediately held my child. You can ask any of them. If I had to send them to their room or something like that, which I rarely did, I would go to them within 5 minutes and be in their room with them. Because I fully believe that the Lord doesn't send us away. I believe the Lord draws near. When we sin, when we fall short, I believe the grace abounds where sin abounds. Grace is not, oh, it's okay, go ahead and keep going. That's not grace. Grace is the divine influence upon the heart. So the only way grace can abound is if it draws near. So when sin abounds, grace abounds all the more. Grace is not just forgiveness and it's okay. No, grace is I draw near so that I can influence your heart rightly. Okay? But if they're sent away to their room and they're in their room for an hour or two by themselves and there's no divine influence, no mom or dad influence upon the heart, then their imagination will roll. They'll begin to think things that you don't want them to think. Because in your absence, vain imaginations, negative thoughts, shame, and guilt begin to pour upon them. And before long, they'll take root if divine grace influence isn't there. Where love comes, sorry, where sin is, their love covers, right? Love covers what? Multitude of sin. And like we have right there, how does love cover? Through distant connection? No. Love draws close, sees the mess, and loves anyway. So what we deal with our children, and you know, honestly, we're just about done with discipline. Thank you, Jesus. At least in the way that we're talking about it now. There's a little bit happening, but not very much. When it does happen, I'll tell you what, within 5 minutes, if they've gone somewhere else to go be alone, one of us is right there. And even if they don't say a word, the point of us being there is to represent the heart of the Father, that when you mess up, He does not step away from you until you get it right. This is one of the main mistakes I've seen. My own parents did it because they didn't know better. And thank God for grace. There's a lot of grace in the world, a lot of mercy. But I want a generation that raises up knowing that when they screw up, Lord draws near for influence. Love knows that when someone's making a mistake, they need more of the better influence, not less. Right? The tribe. And they came near. If you actually saw it, what they did was the entire village surrounded them to the point where they could not move. No matter where the person looked, they saw the eyes of the village. And it was, we know who you are. So you draw near in the midst of that, not separate. Now, it is good to separate them from the situation. So for example, if they're fighting with another sibling, that's not a bad thing. Separate the siblings. That's good. One thing that I'm not crazy about, and this is just more of an opinion than it is anywhere where I can find factual evidence for this, don't force kids to make up. Don't force kids to hug. Don't force your kids to hug your grandparents or their grandparents. Don't force that. If you have to force it, you are teaching them religion. If it does not come from who they are, it's religion. Okay? Any behavior that's not sourced in their original identity is religion. Is a man-made, forced, manipulated behavior that's not sourced in who they are. And I promise you, that will be something that will eventually have to be broken in their lives. Because before long, they will perform to please. Instead, teach them why that couple that just walked in the door are worthy of greater honor. Tell them about who they are. Remind them who those grandparents are. So that when they see their grandparents, come here, Pop. Poof, not be, you go hug your grandma right now. You go hug your sister right now. She's your sister and you should love her. I should love her. Just think about that. Now love is forced. Love has to happen. I have to love. No, you should love from deep within you. Otherwise, it's not love. Is this making sense? I hope it's making sense.
I'll just be honest. I'm very irritated.
Hold on. Get a microphone.
I'm irritated with the fact that everything you just said is everything I do. I do grab my kids and I do drag them because they drive me nuts. I don't want to be around them sometimes because they don't listen to me.
All of that is real. Hey, I'm not telling you everything I always did. I'm telling you what's right.
But it leads deeper. Like, you're talking about anger. Like, my whole entire week has been filled with all of this crap. I feel like it's, like, There's something going on inside of me. What is it that's going on inside of me? What is the perspective that I'm looking at that's not right, that I need to see it differently? And I just want to not go to work. I don't want to go home. I don't know where I want to go.
You want to go where it's easier, right? Because it's hard at work and it's hard at home.
Right now, yes.
Yeah.
And I don't know how to fix it.
I understand. I want to answer what you're saying. Or you didn't really ask anything, but I don't want to fix what's going on here, but I want to just finish this up. I have a responsibility to all of you to declare the standard. Okay? And what often happens when the standard is declared is that instead of being inspired to the standard, you see the gap between you and the standard. And you feel like a failure. You feel like you've messed up. Or, worse, you point at somebody else and say how they messed up. Okay? That is not how you should respond to a standard. It should inspire you. Okay? And if it doesn't inspire you, then you're living in some kind of shame, guilt, or condemnation. And I think that's a little bit of where Becky just came from. There's nothing wrong with that. That is perfectly normal and natural. I'm willing to bet in the last hour, every one of you at some point in time said, oh, crap. Hello? Yeah. And I'm not telling you that I didn't screw up. I did. I messed up. There were times where I jerked my child. But I want to tell you one thing I did. This is one thing I know. I was not always right in what I did, but I always repented when I was wrong. Always. I remember always coming and saying, I really messed up. Sometimes I had to repent to my children for how I treated Dawn. And I would. And I think there is the greater lesson for a child than always doing it right, is repenting when you do it wrong. I don't think there's a better lesson on the planet than when you screw up, even with them. Brayden's ready to understand that. Connor, I'm not so sure.
No, it's Connor.
But I'm just saying, he's not quite at that age yet to understand your repentance.
So I should basically repent to Brayden because he was there and saw it.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that is the beginning of actually your child helping you. My children have corrected me. I haven't always received it really well, but I'll tell you what, man, when they correct me, it cuts to the quick more than anyone else bringing correction to me. I've had them correct me while I'm correcting them. And I want to tell you, there's a couple times where I said, this is not the time for that. I'll receive that in 10 minutes. Right now it's about you. But you said, no buts. Yeah, that's right. We're over here. The standard's there. So to encourage you, Becky, we're all there. We are all there. And I think you're an example of that frustration in one place causes frustration in another place. Where there's, because home's got to be a place of peace. And if home's not a place of peace, then your heart looks for a place of peace somewhere. And where's the other place we normally go? Work. And if work's not peace and home's not peace, then you've got like, I got to go somewhere. I got to get something. So I think I understand where you're coming from. And I think we can talk a little more offline about some of this. I think it'd be good to. One of the things that I want to be really clear about with you as far as the work thing goes, and all of you don't know anything about this, but I think it might could help you. Your authority is being challenged right now at work. And when authority is challenged, the worst thing you can do is back off. Absolute worst thing you can do. You need to actually stand in an opposite spirit of that. Do not submit to someone that's trying to manipulate your leadership, trying to control and steer the way you lead. Becky, you lead from your heart. And you need to stand in that. And if it means you lose people, you lose people. But you're going to lose people loving them and leading them. Yes, will it put you in a pickle? I'm sure it will. But if you submit to a controlling spirit when you're in leadership, you will do it the rest of your life. Okay, Nikki.
Sort of what she's talking about, but I've been kind of sitting here thinking about how my kids are 15 and 12, and how I haven't done all that you were saying with discipline, like walking with them, beside them,
in the is good.
More like what our parents did. We kind of copied what they did.
Sure. Kind of thing.
So I kept thinking it's too late. It's too late to do what you're saying because they're older, but it's not too late.
Right.
And I just was going to say that like to whoever needs to hear it, that it's not too late to do that.
It is never too late. Thank you. Yeah. Okay, lean a mic over here.
There's just something that keeps popping into my heart concerning this, and it's something that I think about all the time. When I'm considering my children and my relationship with them, both walking with them in positive things and walking with them in disciplinary, you know, misbehaviors, because mine are still young. They're still very young. I always realize that I am the first representation of the father to them, both his grace and his correction and his love and his companionship and his celebration of me, all of that stuff. I'm the first person to introduce them to that on the earth. And so when Tice, I already am like pretty, well, he's young, so I can't be too hard on him, but I already smack his hand. No means no already. Because I'd never want my children to look at the father as though he's optional, as though his words can be taken or left. Like, I want my kids to look at the father and to say, I understand authority, I understand grace, I understand that when you talk to me, your words matter. Like, I don't want them to walk in rebellion for long periods of their life because I didn't show them how important I am to them. Like, their identity matters and mine matters. And when they're in Nick and I's home, our identity, who we are, and the standard that we set in our home, one of, you know, we have so much to learn, obviously. But that matters. That is the standard of our home. And when they're in it, as we practice it, that's the standard. Like, and I want us to take ourselves seriously as parents, not as striving to parent, but standing before the Father and saying, I'm important in my home. I'm a king and I'm a leader in my home and I'm setting the culture and I'm training my children to take themselves and me seriously with weight, like to see themselves, to rise up and to see that. And it's, I hate even mentioning these things. I don't want to come off like I'm getting it right. I'm practicing it every day, and I'm probably wrong more than I'm right. But I just want us to contend for our children, to contend for them, to say, I see you, and I'm in this with you, good and bad, and I'm not letting go of what I see. I'm not letting go of it. I looked at Dax the other day, and I said, I will not spend time with this. I will not. I know who you are. I don't know what's going on right now, but I actually held him because I realized something was going on. I will not spend time with this. This is not who you are. I miss Dax. Where are you? And like he actually started to cry because something had happened at school and it didn't occur to him what was going on. But it's important to me. It's that word contending is in there. Like it's a whole family unit to grow up together. I love Mark saying home is where we all get to walk out that. I have to walk it out too. I have to walk out who I am and practice that with my kids. Sorry, that was long.
I want to talk to you because I'm sitting here as a father that left the home, but I left, I believe, for reasons that were more beneficial for me and more beneficial for my daughter. So I'm sitting here feeling like I'm the crappiest father there is because I'm not there. But there's nothing I can do about that. The courts did what they did, and that's just the reality. So how do I parent from a distance and still give that same discipline when I don't see the full realm of everything that's going there?
Can you repeat the question? I want to make sure I understand. You asked a question there.
How do I discipline when My time is
limited.
That 20, 30 minutes on the phone. That's my time I have with my kid. That's the reality. Or the letters I send or
yep.
that. Not the physical being yep. there. Because the courts don't physically let me be there.
Yep. For me, I think the discipline needs to be in your encouragement. In your speaking life to your child. How old?
Nine.
Yeah. Whether it's the time on the phone or the letters, I think they need to know how important they are, how valuable they are, how every bit of their behavior matters, how what they're doing now will eventually affect the world. And if there is a bad behavior issue that you hear about, how would you hear about something? Would the mom tell you or?
The grandmother.
The grandmother would tell you? Okay. The problem I see with bringing correction is that there's not a lot of basis of relationship for the correction to be based on. I think the level of correction I bring is based on the relationship I have. So the degree to which I can speak to turning them from one way to another, I think is based on the bridge of relationship I have. And I'm not sure how strong that bridge is yet with the 9-year-old. Only you can speak to that. But as that bridge strengthens and as more trust gets exchanged between you and them, I think is the degree to which you can then start bringing correction. I would probably be slow to correction and discipline in the way the world sees it, and much stronger in encouragement, believing, speaking life, asking the Lord for words specifically about who they really are so that you can speak life to them. That's what I'd be focusing my time on. Other questions?
So talk about allowing failure to happen.
That's good.
So we, had some issues with some grades, so in my opinion, they weren't where they needed to be based on past performance. And so, and I mostly handled it sort of okay, I think. But, like, yeah, I think you get what I'm saying.
Like, yeah.
Like, how do you call your child up without calling your child out?
Okay.
And how do you, yeah.
Yeah, that's good. First, to your original question about failing, don't let your child fail until they have Don't let your child fail until they have the ability to not let themselves fail.
Yes.
You got that?
What do you mean, let them fail?
Don't let them fail. If they don't have the ability to keep themselves from failing, don't let them fail.
Can
you give an example? Okay, so until they have the ability to choose for themselves not to cross the street, you don't let them cross the street.
Yeah.
Okay? Once they have the ability to look to the right and to the left, then you. Yeah. At some point in time, you're going to have to trust your child that they know when to cross the street or not. That is a scary day. Just as scary as sitting in the passenger seat when your 16-year-old has the keys and you have nothing to control that car. At some point in time, you just extend trust. So, does that statement make sense? I believe we have a responsibility as parents that if they do not have the ability to keep themselves from failing, we have the responsibility to keep them from failing. Once they have that ability, then it's on them. We switch from being the one that keeps them from failing to one that reminds them that they don't have to. But if they choose to fail, you got to let them fail, man. But you are always going to be right there saying, you don't have to do this. I know who you are. I know your ability. I know you've got what it takes. And I believe you hold them accountable, not to your standard, but to who they are. So if you know they're A students and they're giving you B's and C's, you hold them accountable to their A. If they're B or C students, you hold them accountable to that. You know that. That's why it's training up a child in the way they should go. You have to know your child. But I don't do really well in this. I'll be honest with you. And I'm going to use Maddie as the example. Maddie, if you at any point in time don't like this, you can just tell me. And I will stop. I didn't say you could tell me. I said she could tell me. So Maddie's first semester of college just got finished, and she rocked it. But about halfway through it, she was not rocking it. And she would actually come to us, and she would say, I'm not even sure if this should be on internet.
I'll just hit whatever.
All right, yeah, good idea.
Okay, so she would tell me, she would say, okay, guys, I have a test in, what's the class? Political science. I have a political science test, it's online, it's 25 questions, and I have an hour to complete it. Who's going to help me?
You Google it, yeah.
You get to call friends.
If they didn't want to do it, they wouldn't have allowed it.
That's exactly right. So at one point in time in our great room is me, Ben, Marty, Don, and we all have our cell phones, and we're all on Google.
Oh, Lord.
And we're ready to rock this thing. We got a time that we have so many minutes per question, and what was inside of you was, I don't want her to fail.
Yeah.
I don't want her to fail. And there's a part that's like, that's good, and I don't want your child to fail. The bad part is she has the ability to not fail.
Yeah.
But I went ahead and handicapped the situation. So it really wasn't handicapped, because by the time we were all done, there were five of us conferring on every question. Five of us got a 75.
Ouch.
At the end of the test, she goes, guys, I could have done that.
Okay, we're back. She never asked us again. And her grade improved, didn't it? It improved. It did. But it's proof. I was just going to say that. Thank you. Yeah. In fact, you saw that actually our help was not helping. Yeah. Your ability to do it on your own without our help proved that you could actually do it. It strengthened you. I think you're exactly right, Jeff. Absolutely. Failure is necessary to see what's not working. What's okay? I really need the microphone on. Can we work this thing so the microphone's on? Is it just not working? It's dead? We got to make sure the batteries are checked before each service. Next time, please. Go ahead.
I was saying, I think failure is good because it kind of draws out things in me that either need correction or not up to to par. And I feel like if I rely on someone to keep me from failing, there are things that I will never learn because I will learn to rely on someone else for that.
Yep, you're exactly right. There are some things where we need to rely upon other people for, because we don't want to go to the whole other extreme and never rely upon, but you're absolutely right. And failure has been my greatest teacher. I rarely learn anything in success. Why? Why do we rarely learn anything in success?
Because you already know it.
Because I think I already know it. The level of knowledge and stuff I gave to it gave me the success. So why do I need to go any further? I got success. And who's the guy that was the big steel guy in Pittsburgh? Oh, I forget. I don't know if he was a steel guy or not, but I don't even know who it is. It doesn't matter. The point is this. He says, my company never got better when we were successful. My company always got better when we weren't, because it forced us to look for weaknesses in areas where we could improve. I love that. And I think that should apply to our lives too. When things aren't going well, it should not cause shame and condemnation. Oh, crap. No, it should be like, okay, what's not working and what do we need to shift and change so it can work? In any area of your life, that's the way we should be. It should motivate us. Failure can be an incredible motivator.
Okay, so speaking of that, you say that we should not allow our children to fail until they can fail.
Until they have the ability to not fail on their own.
Correct. But then, I guess going back to the contrasting tensions, you just now said that failure can be a great motivator and a teacher. So when you're saying that our children, we should not allow our children to fail, are you more saying that we should not allow our children to fail on their own, and that we are there if they do fail to teach them in that moment, or are we supposed to save them from failing?
Give him the microphone. He doesn't like the way I said something, so he wants to correct it or make it better.
I just think good. The way that he said it was that, you know, you don't want to let your child fail until they have the ability to pass or see something to completion on their own.
Right.
Right. So yeah. I just think the way you said it was a lot of fail, just kind of confused me. Am I paraphrasing correctly?
I think so.
Okay.
Yeah. I don't want to be confusing.
Like if they're not aware.
Yeah, the point is this.
I get
what?
Like, you don't give them more freedom
than they can handle.
Yeah.
Yeah, like, I think I have a responsibility as a parent. Go ahead and say it in the microphone so it can be.
You don't give your child more freedom than they are able to respond to well and to handle.
Yeah. I don't think we're handicapping our children to keep them from failing when they can't do it on their own. I don't think we're handicapping our child at all. I think we're keeping them safe. I think we're telling them that we care, and we're showing them that there is a higher power that watches out for them. Okay, I think that's a good thing. But once they grow to the place where they don't touch the stove because they know it's hot, that they don't cross the street because they know cars are coming. Are you hearing me?
I am. I wanted to... Okay, so I think I'm thinking of failure as a different way than you're thinking of failure. You're thinking of failure as something that's going to be able to harm them, like touching the stove or getting hit by a car or something along those
right.
lines. In my mind, I'm thinking of failure as a teaching moment in life.
So give me an example of what you're talking
of
about.
Of like when in like grades in school. I mean,
yeah, they have the ability to make that better.
Exactly. And so like with my children, they're 10 and 7. There's still moments where they're failing in either listening to their parents or doing something that they know they're not supposed to do. And so in my mind, that's a failure in being who they are or who they're supposed to be. But it's not a failure where it's going to harm them.
Oh, it is.
Well, not – I meant physical harm.
Okay.
So like getting
hit by a car. But you apply that principle of physical harm to mental, emotional, spiritual later in life. So yes, it's still harm.
Okay.
And it's not just harm to them, it's also harm to other people.
Okay.
Yeah.
Fair enough.
So what we do in that process, once they mature to the place where they can fail on their own or succeed on their own, that's back to his point, to succeed on their own, then I think we have a responsibility to walk alongside of them. And when they're walking in an area where they can succeed on their own and they fail, it doesn't mean you're off lollygagging, doing whatever you want. No, you're still right there with your 10-year-old. You're allowing that failure because they're going to need you to sit back up and try again. They're going to need your grace and love to get up and try again. But you allowed that failure. Yeah.
So is it safe to say that they're, like, you have to know your child well enough to know if now's the time to let them,
yep.
let them fail to learn?
Yep.
Because, you know, maybe... I don't even have a good example, but maybe when they're 3 years old, mm-hmm. there is something they're allowed to fail in so that they can learn from
exactly.
it.
Exactly.
But there are other areas that, no, that's
mm-hmm. exactly
not
right.
ready for it.
You got to know your child.
Yeah.
Yep. And that's why I think walking in relationship with them when things are good will show you at 16, okay, they're ready for the keys, or they're ready for money, or they're ready for a real job. Yeah, because that's one of the things, I think when we don't, this simple principle that I think you've worded better than me, Reese, about freedom and succeed, the ability to succeed on their own, is if we don't do this now, then we're going to hand our kids off to employers. I can't tell you how many parents have done this to Dawn and I. And I guess they expect us to teach them work ethic and what it means to handle responsibility. And I can promise you, that my business is not a place for you to learn that. You can learn a skill. You can learn how to treat customers and things like that. There's some things you can learn on, but you will not learn a work ethic on my shift. Nope. You learn that before you get here. Go somewhere else. In fact, go back home. Do dishes at home before you wash mine and make them look like crap when you put them back out there. So I think that's why this is so important to start thinking this way now for our children, 10 and 7, for example, because one day they might work at Fudd's, and you better be having them learn a work ethic now or they won't last long there. And that's the problem. Our families and our homes are putting people into the world that are still children. And as long as the heir is a child, Galatians 4, verse 1, they're no different than a slave. That's what Galatians 4, 1 says. And if you've put a slave in the world, then it will be looking for a master. Because that's all they know. Instead of looking for a place to own. And it's the next verse, or the next words of Galatians 4, 1 is, though they're the owner of everything. So what we have is someone who actually has the ability to walk as a full owner and walk responsibly, but they're still a slave because they never grew up. That's what our responsibility is as parents, to mature kids to the place where they're out in the workplace. I can run your restaurant for you. You give me 6 months to learn everything about this place, and then you can go. You give me that kid? I'm looking for parents like that. And I think we all have that ability. And all of our children have that ability. There aren't some that can and some that can't. Nope. I think there are some that have given the opportunity to, and given the right home to raise up in, and then others that weren't given that opportunity. That's what I think. Go read Ben Carson's biography. Have you ever read it?
Yeah.
It's incredible. And that's an example of somebody, you don't need a certain upbringing. Maybe you need the right people around you. You don't need a certain poverty level or rich level to be successful. Nope, you just need the right people around you. You need some people that believe in you, people that won't let you get away with stuff, that won't take your tests for you. So,
I stole this from Chris, but give you an example. I was talking with somebody at work the other day, and their phone went off like an alarm or whatever. I said, oh, what's that? You know, do you have a meeting? No, I need to call my son, tell him to get up for work. And so I happen to know her son. And I said, now how old is he? And she said, he's 26. So that's too old to have your mom call you to get up for work. And she has an alarm set on her phone for that. So
I don't need to say anything to that, do I?
I think my point was jumping in like a little bit a while ago, but I think it's important for us that as we start raising the kids that some of the things that we protect them from failure from, we don't accidentally start instilling fear of things into them. Because I've seen it, and I think it's been done to me where a lot of things growing up, you know, don't do that because you're afraid to do that. Or my mom was afraid of us doing this. And so it should almost make us afraid to do it. But we need to make sure that we do it in like wisdom and encouragement so that we know maybe we can't do this now, but it's okay to do later, you know.
And
that
excellent.
We're not afraid to even take steps to grow in areas later on.
Right on. Very good. Can you get a microphone back to Holly?
I'd like to share a little bit about, sorry.
I didn't know who was talking.
I don't take very often, so. But Michaela was homeschooled from seventh grade, and we were talking about grades early and her ability, and
the ability to keep up with the grades and all that. And growing up, I was not able to keep up with the grades. I didn't know why, but I couldn't do it. I couldn't. So when Michaela hit seventh grade, she was like, I want homeschooled. I can't handle school. And I'm like, well, I can't teach you because I couldn't do school. But with the Lord's prompting, we decided to homeschool. She did cyber school in seventh and eighth grade. And ninth grade, she was 2 weeks into school, and she had an F in three subjects. She could not function. And I didn't have the ability and strength in me to walk as a son to teach her, because I couldn't do it. So with a lot of research and a lot of digging into what is going on, we discovered that she is dyslexic, and so am I. Not that it's a disability. It's just the way God has created us. So we don't learn easily the way the world wants to teach us. So I have had to restructure her whole curriculum and teach her the way she can learn. And so in that process, she is now in her senior year, and she does her own curriculum. She does what I tell her to do, and she flies right through it, and she loves it, to the point where she now has a job in an office working 3 days a week, and the boss is like, I want to teach it all to you so I don't have to be here. But if I didn't look for what she needed to promote her into what she could do, I'm not sure where she would be. But take each kid and look at where they are and how they learn and how they function to truly teach them. Because she's now stepping into places that I wouldn't have stepped into at 17. There's no way, because I wasn't taught. I wasn't promoted into who I was because I didn't know any different.
Any other thoughts, questions? Is there a mic close? There's only one now, so. Oh, there is two? We back to two? Good. Thank you.
You can go.
I've learned that instead of saying, no, don't do that, I say, I can't have you do that. You're better than that. Even though she's 18 months old, she will revert back to what she's supposed to be doing. Like, instantly, instead of keep on saying, no, 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 she's learned that I see better than that. Because if I say no, she'll keep doing it. Does that make sense? Is that okay?
Sure. It is.
We were just talking up here. We wanted to, before you guys leave, just get together, like, all the moms and dads up here, and we just want to kind of speak into you guys and pray for you a little bit, if that's cool with Mark.
Do your thing.
Come on up.